Squads continued to roll throughout the city and accompanying suburbs. Police officers watched night and day steadfastly for anyone even closely fitting that description, but didn't find their man. And, in the meantime, his crimes continued without a sign of let-up, his ferocity building. The nature of the next attack, which occurred on June 1st, the day after the assault on Wilson, added another and an alarmingly new perspective to the suspect. He suddenly took on a Satanist role and his deeds as sacrificial rituals to the Lord Master of Evil. It would be his most aggressive and horrific action to date. Retired schoolteacher Malvia Keller and invalid sister Blanche Wolf, 83 and 79 years old, respectively, were viciously beaten in their small house in suburban Monrovia, off one of the Central State freeways. When found by their gardener the following morning, both older women had been beaten across the head with a hammer. Wolf lay near the point of death, oozing blood from a head wound. She had been raped. Keller, who had succumbed, had had her legs and arms bound and had been crushed by a heavy table which the killer had turned over across her ribs. Police found a pentagram, an encircled five-pointed star often linked to satanic worship, drawn in lipstick on Malvia Keller's thigh, writes Clifford L. Linedicker in his Night Stalker. Another pentagram had been crudely scrawled in lipstick on the bedroom wall where Blanche Wolf lay in a comatose state. The tip of the pentagram was inverted, pointing down, an indication of evil. Of Satan. This indication of devil worship was no surprise to Los Angeles County Sheriff Sherman Block, who had, for some time, suspected the crimes to be of that origin. A black baseball-style cap bearing the emblem of the hard rock group AC/DC found at the scene of Dale Okazaki's murder had given him that impression. That music group was known for having produced some lyrics with cultist overtones. Reads the Los Angeles Times, authorities focused on AC/DC's 1979 Highway to Hell album and its six-minute, Night Prowler, cut, which says, in part, "What's the noise outside your window? What's the shadow on the blind? As you lay there naked like a body in a tomb, suspended animation as I slip into your room." Block had seen enough murder in his years as a police officer to recognize the differences between homicides of various degrees, drug-related, love triangle, cultist, and so on. This string of killings was the most bizarre in his years of law enforcement experience. Dispiritedly, all he and his men had to go on at this stage of the game was a generic description of the assailant and the flimsy roots of motive. The devil's own remained elusive, and that's all that mattered, unfortunately. It had now become apparent that, like a vampire of folklore, the demon had grown and was growing stronger by the moment, more degenerate with every sip of blood. Over the next 6 weeks, the Los Angeles area would endure a series of killings so brutal that the city was thrown into a panic that took on the appearance of a cataclysm. Many sleepless nights were had by citizens, especially by women who lived alone. No lock was sufficient in the minds of the frightened public. No door bolt thick enough. No window latch secure enough. Because the killer's victims ranged all ages, no one, man or woman, child or spinster, felt safe. Some of his victims were of Oriental culture, others were Caucasian, and the city wondered, who the hell next? Some writers claimed that the killer, who by all eyewitness testimony was believed to be Hispanic, had not picked on his own, yet they forgot Maria Hernandez, whose keyring had saved her life on a mid-March morning. The killer had not exhibited a rabid preference for any particular culture, age group, sex, or even geographic area. His killing spanned a 40-mile range encircling Greater LA. He was, as Linedicker observes, an equal opportunity killer. His modus operandi remained consistent, and his motives inexplicable. His break-ins, while well orchestrated, even ritualistic, had, at the same time, earmarks of sexual spontaneity, as if a single spark of impure thought caused havoc so hot in his brain that, to ease the torture, he needed to torture others. Between June 1, immediately following the Monrovia affair, and mid-August 1985, nine more bloody rampages were attributed to what the newspapers were calling, for lack of a better name, the Valley Intruder. The toll of his victims included Patty Higgins, 32 years old, Arcadia. June 27, killed in her home, her throat slashed. Mary Louise Cannon, 75 years old, Arcadia. July 2, found in her home, beaten, throat slashed. Deidre Palmer, 16 years old, Arcadia. July 5, beaten at home with a tire iron. Survived. Joyce Lucille Nelson, 61 years old, Monterey Park, July 7, bludgeoned to death and mutilated in her house. Linda Fortuna, 63 years old, Monterey Park, also July 7, survived rape and sodomy attempts when the attacker could not get an erection. He robbed her home and, fortunately, let her live. Maxon and Leela Niding, husband and wife, 66 and 64 years old respectively, Glendale, July 20, shot in their beds while they slept, mutilated after death. Maxon's head was nearly decapitated. Asawahem family, Sun Valley, also July 20, husband Chetat, 32 years old, shot in bed at point-blank range, his 29-year-old wife Sakima dragged from bed, beaten, twice raped, and made to perform oral sex. While bound, Sakima was forced to listen as the killer slapped her 8-year-old son in his bed. Afterward, intruder departed with family cash. Christopher and Virginia Peterson, husband and wife, 38 and 27 years old respectively, Northridge, August 5. Both shot in the head while they were in bed. Both somehow survived despite a bullet that penetrated a section of Christopher's brain and another that blew away Virginia's face. Ahmed and Sue Kyazia, husband and wife, 35 and 28 years old respectively, Diamond Bar, August 8. Ahmed shot in the temple and killed in the couple's bed. Wife Sue handcuffed, slapped, punched, raped, and forced to perform fellatio on an intruder. She survived. Horrified columnists referred to the mystery murderer in several ways. Nicknames abounded, all of them colorful, the Valley Intruder, and the Walk-In Killer, enjoying the longest run. It was not until the Los Angeles Herald-Examiner started calling him the Night Stalker that the city had found his true idiom. The moniker, sharp and straightforward, like a knife, stabbed the bull's eye. It frightened, and it numbed. And the name stuck. Like a lump in the throat. It penetrated like a shiv in the guts of those who heard it, especially those who lived in the communities where the stalker stalked. Los Angeles was terrified. In Los Angeles County, both the county and municipal police were anything but idle. They recognized and admitted to the enormity of their problem as long as the Night Stalker was free to roam. No one was safe, but how, they wondered, leash a mad dog that seems to be invisible? More than any other lawman, Detective Sergeant Frank Salerno of the County Department's Homicide Squad was the man most apropos to answering that riddle. He knew how tricky the mind of a homicidal maniac could be to box and tag, having played a significant role in tracking down LA's Hillside Stranger a decade earlier. He was, for that matter, the first to sense that the Valley had another serial killer on the loose. In June 1985, not long after the killings began, Salerno took it upon himself to list similarities in the up to then six murders in suburban Los Angeles. Certain things matched. Collected fingerprints, recovered cartridge shells, .22 caliber, and even a particular breaking and entry method, all the same. Images of identical design tennis shoe, identified as Reebok High Tops, size 11, told a startling tale. But, more revealing still, The description of the killer himself was nearly identical in each case where a living person had been left to talk. Tall, gaunt, dark, Hispanic, in his late 20s, early 30s. Downright ugly. And now, signs of devil worship were surfacing in many of the killings. Apart from the pentagrams discovered at Malvia Keller's house, the murderer had, according to survivors such as Ruth Wilson, demanded that they mouth such phrases as, "I vow to Satan," or, "I love Satan," or he would kill them. Nor had Salerno forgotten the baseball cap with the rock group AC/DC's emblem, found after the Okazaki murder. He recalled that one of the band's songs hinted at Satanism. He took this evidence to his superior, Captain Robert Grimm, who was impressed. Grimm, Salerno sought and gained permission to check with the LA City forces to compare notes. Perhaps, he thought, they had been encountering like cases, unsolved, which might correspond to the elusive killer's track record. Grimm recognized the wisdom in Salerno's suggestion to check with LAPD, reports Clifford L. Linedicker in Night Stalker. No one wanted a situation similar to the Hillside Strangler case, when both the LAPD and the Los Angeles Sheriff's deputies worked their investigations alone and independent of each other. The result for the police agencies had been missed opportunities, confusion, and embarrassment. Salerno and Grimm envisioned a task force comprised of the top police investigators throughout the county and Los Angeles. After discussion with the LAPD, the latter decided that it would invest in its separate task force but promised to work around the clock and closely with Salerno, who had already been given a squad of detectives dedicated to finding the Night Stalker. While separate entities, both investigative teams operated, as committed as one, feeding information back and forth and partnering in any activities to maintain a single direction. Salerno, in the meantime, conferred with two of his top men who had directed the investigative efforts in two of the Stalker's previous crimes. They proved invaluable in formatting the investigative team and in keeping its work strategic. Detective Gil Carrillo had been one of the first plainclothesmen introduced to the Night Stalker's handiwork when he was assigned to the Okazaki shooting. Besides being familiar with this latest serial killer's history, Salerno called on Carrillo's intrinsic knowledge of computers, a technical expertise Salerno lacked, to create a database for incoming and outgoing information. On the other hand, Detective Russell Ulleth helped Salerno determine the psychopath they were dealing with. His study of the Zazara butchery showed that the mutilations ravaged on Mrs. Zazara were done after she was dead. The gouging out of the eyes that the killer took with him, was enacted as a sort of satanic cult act. But, while his formidable adversaries were seeding the roots of war against him, the Night Stalker managed to slip by them in the cover of darkness to commit the murders of Higgins, Cannon, Nelson, Nighting, and Asawahem. This series of tragedies necessitated that, by early August, the task force more directly include the suburban law enforcement agencies around Los Angeles where the devil continued to hunt. With a workforce of 200 investigators, it was the largest operation of its kind ever created. Besides the full-time force, Salerno called in subject experts from the Federal Bureau of Investigation's Criminal Profiling Unit who presented their views of known types of serial killers, then narrowed the types to which the Night Stalker came closest. Not leaving a stone unturned, the task force even consulted personalities with knowledge on devil worship and cultist torture rituals. Investigators, following the Satan cult theory, fell on places where such groups assembled. They questioned followers of these leagues about their membership, hoping that they might uncover the killer's identity in their company. While they could not locate a suspect, they did find something exciting on the floor of an East Los Angeles cult hall. They found a shoe print that matched the Reebok tennis shoes imprint, size 11, located at many of the murder scenes. Salerno wanted the killer to feel the heat, panic, and blunder into the open through his hysteria. The detective had seen it happen often. Criminals, feeling the pressure, leap before looking and announce their guilt hands up by doing something stupid. To meet this end, he ensured that the task force started feeding the media pieces of evidence they uncovered, large and small, even unfounded information, to give the killer the impression they were closing in. Simultaneous to the big squeeze, in August, the task force announced its formation at a press conference, keynoted by representatives from the county sheriff's office. At the meeting, which was heavily attended by an anxious press, the speakers officially confirmed the existence of a dangerous serial killer wandering at will in the Los Angeles Valley. "We are concerned there is an individual who is responsible for more than one murder, multiple murders," admitted Robert A. Edmonds, Los Angeles County Assistant Sheriff. However, County Sheriff Sherman Block assured the public that all surrounding police agencies were combing the streets to end the spree. Authorities asked the people to keep calm, keep doors locked, and report any suspicious activities or persons in their neighborhoods as soon as they manifested. The press conference kicked off a campaign to make the public more aware of, and to make it more active in the apprehension of, the Night Stalker. Salerno's task force distributed flyers, leaflets, and wanted posters bearing the composite sketch of the killer. Posters soon hung in every visible passage in every public byway and thoroughfare and market within and around Los Angeles. A citizen couldn't take a stroll to the corner store or drive their kids to school without coming face to face with the large sketched ugly face of the Night Stalker. And things began to pop. Telephone calls from men and women, some calling anonymously, poured in. Faceless voices and unsigned letters of concern led police to strange goings-on in their neighborhood or two oddball neighborhood characters who fit the Night Stalker's description. Not a lead was overlooked. Transients, vagrants, and vagabonds were questioned, as were those oddball neighborhood characters. The terror that had gripped the people of Los Angeles had now, prompted by the police, turned to obstinacy. The populace transformed from a group of frightened individuals into a committee of daring hunters, begging for their chance to catch the nighttime ghoul. If he wanted to prey on them, well, they cried, let him prey, because now they were waiting. The family man and the businessman and the housewife, they had bought guns and loaded them. Or they had as their weapons shovels, or pickaxes, or kitchen knives, or any one of dozens of homemade utensils pointing their way to a Night Stalker's heart. Suddenly, the Night Stalker realized that things had changed. He found their lights burning at night, a silhouette in the window. Suddenly he found apartment buildings with hired guards pacing the lobby. Suddenly he found citizens' committees strolling roundabout and in and out in the alleys, the parks, the streets. Suddenly he discovered their windows nailed shut, porch lights left on, backyards illumined by safety beams. Suddenly he found defiance. The civic forces, too, were out in droves. Patrol cars were everywhere, marked and unmarked vehicles. Townsfolk volunteers had been deputized, as well, to drive in the dark, licensed to throw their search beams at anything that moved or crept or crawled. And if it resembled the Night Stalker, to step on it. The devil, the ghost, the ghoul, the phantom, the stalker. It was time for him to leave Los Angeles. He shrugged. After all, no matter. He would go elsewhere. He could kill anywhere. As the sun descended over San Francisco on the evening of August 17, 1985, a beat-up brownish-red 1978 Pontiac Grand Prix pulled off Highway 80 and began to cruise the adjacent suburbs that bordered it. Within the next couple of hours, the car found its way into Lake Merced's upper-scale neighborhood. It was well after dark, the time of evil. Parking his car in the darkest spot he could find, the Night Stalker emerged and, checking for the .22 caliber handgun in his belt, headed to one particular two-story home where, he felt, the devil was directing him. Tall, Gaunt, dark, ugly 25-year-old Richard Ramirez paused. He turned to look back at the Pontiac he had been driving these last few weeks. He contemplated a moment and decided after tonight, he'd better play it safe and ditch this auto. It was time to steal another one, perhaps before the sun rose. But, first things first, he drew the revolver, so tight, so hard, so metallic in the moonlight, and strolled casually to the unlit gangway beside the home of an elderly Chinese couple, Mr. and Mrs. Pan. Houses like these were so easy to penetrate, Ramirez knew. Windows low to the ground, removable screens. A snap, a slight push, and he was in. Of course, Satan was guiding his every move, and he knew that. Why fret about getting caught? All these homes, and yet not once had the resident heard him entering. The devil silenced their ears while they slept. And he, Richard Ramirez, then took it a step further. He silenced them, forever. More blood to feed hell, to keep its furnaces burning. Inside the house, Ramirez looked at his watch. Midnight. A good time to kill. He checked his weapon once more. Yes, cylinder loaded. These homes were all laid out pretty much the same. He knew where the bedrooms were by instinct. Without pause, he walked to where the couple slept, found them snoring, and pulled the trigger. He loved the way their bodies jerked upon impact. His senses tingled. Watching them rattle in death, hearing their throats beg for air, watching as their pillows darkened with life's liquid underneath what was left of their skulls. But, there was no time to admire his latest artwork. There was much more work to do here before he left. The time for a bit of home decorating was so that the police would know that the night stalker was far from trapped. When the Pan's son visited his parents the following day, he walked into the aftermath of doomsday. His father was dead in bed, his mother next to him, seriously injured. The home walls were etched with lipstick diagrams of devil worship, cursing, and alien messages such as, "Jack the Knife." Drawers were ransacked. A side window had been pried open and dirty footprints, bearing a Reebok design, trailed hastily from the windowsill across the carpet, in and out of the parents' bedroom. Mrs. Alberta Pan survived but remained an invalid. Her husband Peter was pronounced dead at General Hospital. San Francisco police knew immediately that the horror of Los Angeles, the Night Stalker, had come to their city. Indeed, the modus operandi bore his logo, breaking an entry, the male's assassination first where a couple was involved, and the cultist signatures left on the scene. Bullets retrieved from the victims, when matched with those in possession of the Los Angeles Task Force, confirmed it. So did the shoe prints. Comparing notes with Detective Salerno, San Francisco homicide detective Frank Kowalski also learned that a brown 1978 Pontiac, which had been reported prowling the streets of Lake Merced the night of the Pan killing, matched the description of an auto seen in the vicinity of the most recent murders in the LA area. Undoubtedly, the same car, the same maniac. Authorities began wondering if the same man who perhaps traveled between LA and San Francisco might have committed four other recent unsolved homicides in San Francisco. In retrospect, they now seem to have been. On February 1st, police discovered the mutilated bodies of Christina Caldwell, 58, and her sister, Mary, 70. They were stabbed dozens of times, reports the San Francisco Chronicle. A coroner's report said a window of their ransacked flat was left open. Bloody fingerprints, palm prints, and shoe prints were left behind. Although, Detective Kowalski noted most of the prints turned out to be those of neighbors. Another slaying being checked is that of Masataka Kobayaki, 45, part owner and chef of Masses, a fashionable restaurant on Knob Hill, the Chronicle continues. The fourth murder involved Edward F. Wildgins, 29, who was shot June 2 through the right temple by a late-night intruder. He died 2 days later. His girlfriend fought off the attacker, but was raped. After interviewing the girlfriend, Nancy Bryan, her tormentor's description coincided with the image of the Night Stalker. Without delay, law enforcers in the city by the bay disseminated wanted posters and leaflets. The whole department has been mobilized to apprehend the suspect, promised Richard Clapp, the police commissioner. Patrols were doubled at night, particularly in Hispanic neighborhoods where one nationality might easily blend in. According to the Los Angeles Times, investigators quickly learned that a male resembling the Night Stalker had stayed at the Bristol, a transient hotel at 56 Mason Street, during the week of the Pan murder. Manager Alex Melnikov remembered the lodger as dressing in all black and reeking of body odor. The stranger had signed out the afternoon of the said crime. Melnikov said the paper had found an inverted five-pointed star, known as a pentagram, inscribed on the door of a room adjacent to one occupied by the boarder. A similar star was found in the Pan's home. Richard Ramirez had abandoned the Pontiac, and he had left San Francisco. In haste. He chuckled, huddled behind the wheel of a stolen 1976 orange Toyota, thinking about why he had to make a quick departure. How that mayor of San Francisco, what's her name? Dianne Feinstein, mouthed off to those news station people about the police feel like they were closing in on the Night Stalker. Then how that county sheriff had a fit because she had screwed up the whole dragnet. Locos. Crazy people they. Now, turning the Toyota's grill off the Golden State Freeway towards the community's entrance, known as Mission Viejo, he determined to show them locos just who is the smartest one. The devil protected him. But, they had no one. Tonight, someone would die, not in San Francisco as the police suspected, but here in this rich boy community so near to Los Angeles. The date was August 25th, just after midnight. William Cairns and his fiancée Renata Gunther dreamed well tonight in the home on Crisanta Drive. Parking his car in shadow, Ramirez entered their fine stucco home and sought out the bedroom to see who slept there. He smiled when he saw the couple sound asleep. Both looked young, in their late 20s, and the beautiful Renata tingled his senses. Beauty for the sacrificial altar. For Lucifer. Out came his revolver, the .22, and he flashed its barrel toward the male's skull. Cairns twitched and gagged. Renata awoke to the dark, skinny, grinning Ramirez, who leaned over her, panting, calling her bitch, shaking her, and laughing in her face. His breath stank, his teeth, she could see them in the umbrage, were crooked and stained. His eyes blazed. Forcing her from her bed, he threw himself over her and raped her. Snarling in her face, he promised to shoot her unless she swear to Satan. Begging for her life, she did as he asked. But, before he released her from his grasp, he thrust her head to where he unzipped his trousers. Having performed, he left her alive but in pain and nauseated. He had repaired back into the darkness from whence he came. A middle-aged woman named Donna Myers and her friend, Serafin Arredondo, who lived in the El Sobrante district of San Francisco, had come forth in the meantime with a fascinating tale. Myers, who let out her home occasionally as a boarding house, had from time to time rented a room to a man she knew only as Ricky. She told police he was tall, gaunt, Hispanic, and, in a word, strange. What's more, he closely resembled the police sketch of the Night Stalker that appeared in the Chronicle. Ricky was from El Paso, Texas, she explained, and traveled throughout California, mostly between San Francisco and Los Angeles. To her, he often addressed his interest in the black arts. She related that one day, during a recent stay, she happened to come into her TV room when Ricky was viewing a news report about a Night Stalker victim. He seemed greatly interested in the program. Noticing her behind him, Ricky suddenly turned to her from his chair, grinned with a mouthful of crooked teeth, and whispered, "Now wouldn't you be surprised if I turned out to be the stalker?" She thought at the time it was just a sick bit of whimsy until she noticed the composite in the newspaper shortly after that. The memory chilled her. Arredondo, a friend of the Myers family who often visited the woman, displayed some men's jewelry, a diamond ring and cufflinks, he had bought from this Ricky one afternoon not long ago. Ricky had claimed he was strapped for cash and was selling these items at a discount. He gave Arredondo a good deal. Since then, the buyer had read that the Night Stalker was known for robbing his victims as well as slaying them and wondered if, well, just maybe. The police nodded, they understood completely. Taking the goods that Arredondo offered, they handed them over to the investigative team for possible identification. That evening, the ring and links were labeled as a stolen property that once belonged to one of the killer's male victims. Never knowing when this Ricky might turn up at Myers' doorstep, plainclothes officers began surveillance on her home night and day. A rhythm of lucky breaks was in full tempo. While this was occurring in the Bay Area, eyewitnesses in the Mission Viejo neighborhood near LA had reported seeing an orange, older make of Toyota prowling their streets immediately prior to the attack on Carnes and Gunther. On April 27, the book Night Stalker tells us, the orange Toyota station wagon was found in a parking lot in the Rampart area of Los Angeles. Detectives watched the car for almost 24 hours before deciding it had indeed been abandoned and the stalker was not going to return for it. But, the discovery of the auto would prove fruitful. Dusting the car for fingerprints, city investigators delivered the prints to the Orange County Sheriff's Office, whose forensic laboratory tested a brand new Department of Justice-created system for tracking prints in record time. The prints matched those of a small-time thief and miscreant from Texas named Ricardo Ramirez. Lauded the Los Angeles Times, the system picked Ramirez's fingerprints out of 380,000 other sets. Only 3 minutes after the system was fed a partial print lifted from the Toyota. The need to capture the Night Stalker was so urgent that the installation of the new CalID computer system, which is still in progress, was interrupted so the system could be reprogrammed to search for the Night Stalker's prints. The police had a name. Now they needed to research the suspect to find out more about him. And, most importantly, they needed to find him before he slew again. Ricardo Ramirez was born in the Barrio, Hispanic section, of El Paso, Texas, on February 28, 1960. His childhood was one of poverty and of hanging with youth gangs. Parents Julian, an illegal alien who worked in the rail yard, and Mercedes had, in all, seven children. Ricardo, who later Americanized the name to Richard, was the youngest. Roman Catholics, Mercedes tried as best she could to lead her family onto a straight and God-like path. She succeeded with six of her brood. But, Ricardo went astray. Grade school teachers claimed he could have been a good pupil had he proffered a little interest. He failed ninth grade twice, spending more time in the video arcades than at school. At an early age, he took to breaking into homes. Police caught him in the act of burglary several times, each time being shipped off to a work program, until the oft-time loser was sentenced in his youth to a disciplinarian hall. He had but three interests in junior high, and cared about little else: martial arts, marijuana, and heavy metal. He loved Black Sabbath and Judas Priest, remarks a friend from his teen years. Another interest grew from, say, boyhood friends, the sort of music he listened to that glorified cultist practices. He seemed preoccupied with Satanism and stories about black magic, demons, and dragons. While his mother sent him to Bible studies, hoping he'd learn the Christian ways of life, Richard took the lessons to heart, but learned them in reverse. That is, after class, he would go to the library and read up on Satan and the fallen angels, The characters that his teachers merely skipped over while exemplifying Jesus Christ and the 12 apostles. Richard, in his teens, had been suspected of thievery, but the police could not prove their accusations. His first formal arrest as an adult was for possession of marijuana. Slapped with a small fine, he was then hit with another when pinched months later for the same offense. On his third arrest, for reckless driving, a friend's car, he avoided prison by agreeing to do neighborhood youth work while on 3 years probation. At 20 years old, his probation ended, Richard Ramirez left El Paso. Between the time he departed his native Texas and the time he took up killing innocent people, Richard Ramirez encountered minor run-ins with the law. In 1984, he was taken into custody and photographed while suspected of driving a stolen car, a charge that came to nothing. Ramirez is known to have gone by several aliases, accounts a retrospective article in the Los Angeles Times, including Richard Moreno, Noah Jimenez, Nicolaus Adami, Richard Munoz, and Richard Mona. But, in all, aside from simple infractions, he did little more than waste away slowly in the drug and booze bars of Southern California, wearing black, always black, salivating over Satan and freaking out on the flimsy, filmy veils of burning dragon weed. No matter how evil, no matter how hideous, all things can be destroyed. Caliban shrinks from his reflection. Prometheus scalds from the fire he created. Warlocks recoil from the druid stone. Werewolves perish with a silver bullet. And vampires wither under sunlight. Richard Ramirez, closest to the latter, should have known better than to step out from under the blood moon into the broad daylight. He was a creature of the night. But, the shadows would no longer hide him. On the bright morning of Saturday, August 31, 1985, Ramirez stepped from a Greyhound bus that had just pulled into the Los Angeles Depot from Phoenix, Arizona. He had gone there immediately following the Carnes' killing to buy cocaine from a seller he knew there. Still somewhat depleted from its effects, he returned to LA, the scene of his crimes, probably already scheming his next foray into depravity. He did not know that the police in the meantime had learned his identity, nor that his face and name appeared for the first time in print in that morning's newspapers across the nation. He strutted past the depot's newsstand, oblivious to his black and white visage scowling into the world, and grabbed a rapid transit to the East Side Barrio. The man suspected of so many atrocities was first spotted clad in black jeans and a Jack Daniels t-shirt at about 8:30 a.m. Saturday when he entered a small liquor store at 819 S Town Avenue and picked up a newspaper that had his picture on the first page, the Los Angeles Times relates. According to the store clerk, Ramirez, who was waiting for the cashier to ring up his whiskey purchase, panicked when he realized what he was looking at. He threw the paper down and hot-footed from the store. Citizens in the market had already recognized him and pursued him. They yelled out, "Stop, killer! Halt, El Matador!" Weaving through the Spanish-speaking neighborhood that he knew so well but which had suddenly turned so foreboding, he made his way circuitously corner after corner to the 800 block of Mott Street. It was the beginning of the Labor Day weekend, and residents were out this sunny morning. Streets and porches brimmed with early risers, with strollers and shoppers on their way to shopping, and dog walkers being yanked by their pets to the nearest fire hydrant. All their heads turned in his direction. There seemed to be a neon sign above him, directing their attention to the gaunt, ugly, pockmarked face they had just seen over their cup of Java at the breakfast table. And they cried again, "El Matador. It's him, the killing one. The killing machine." When he ran, several of them waved down a passing police car and pointed out the direction of the night stalker's flight. When other residents phoned in a few moments later, claiming to have seen the fugitive a few blocks away, seven squads were dispatched to the scene at Euclid and Garnet. Street after street, the crews fanned out, following residences leads along a zigzag course. One, maybe even two or three people might be wrong, the police ascertained, but not an entire neighborhood. The cops knew they had their man, and he was turned in by his people. It was Ramirez's turn to live a nightmare. Finally. About him, the brownstone and slat board walls of the barrio were closing in so tight that the lack of space squeezed his chest to take his breath away. Under the dirty Jack Daniels logo, he wore on his chest, his heart hammered his bones, and it ached like the devil that had deserted him. No escape from the world now, no escape from this bad dream. He had manufactured this mania, after all, in the night, and in the day it came back to, at last, haunt the hell out of him. Pointing fingers and jeers and twisted faces and taunts and open palms blocked him every move. Detours led to other detours. The place he had for so long used to blend in had broken loose, overused and indignant. He had shamed his people, and they were hurling him through a gamut. Police sirens screamed from everywhere, and Richard Ramirez began to sob. His world came tumbling down, blurred in tears and sweat. He paused briefly at one woman's screen door. "Por favor, help me," he implored. She saw the mob of neighbors assembling below her stoop, pointing at the hombre estúpido. "You're him," she shrieked and slammed the inner door shut in his face. Desperate and near exhaustion, night stalker Richard Ramirez made a wrong turn when he dashed onto Hubbard Street. Unknowingly, he had stumbled into a neighborhood of heroes, the Los Angeles Times continues. Four citizens grabbed and subdued the suspected murderer after a 20-second foot race, one of them pounding at him with a steel rod. The heroes who captured Ramirez were Manuel de la Torre, 32, and three of his neighbors across the street, Jose Burgoyne, 55, and his sons Jamie, 21, and Julio, 17. Another hero was Faustino Pinnon, 56, the next-door neighbor of the Burgoynes, who had fought off Ramirez when he tried to steal his daughter's car. By the time the first squad arrived screeching onto the scene, the Burgoyne boys had the night stalker pinned to the curb. What fight had remained in him was subdued with both boys' fists and the steel whip. He was bleeding from the pups. The man who had killed, maimed, and raped without mercy whimpered now and trembled now, like a scared puppy, dazed by the detonation of events. Wasn't it only a few moments earlier he had stepped off the Greyhound, independent and carefree? Cuffed and shoved into the backseat of the squad car, the night stalker, brushing filthy tears from his cheek, made a strange request of the arresting deputy. "Shoot me now, man. I don't deserve to live." For once, Los Angeles and Richard Ramirez were of one mind. In particular, the Nation, the prosecuting district attorney's office, expected Senor Night Stalker's case to be open and shut, adios, and go to the death chamber quick. After all, the evidence was there, and more details were zipping in as collected by the prosecution team's crack headhunter units.